So let's start with a warm-up round. We shall wait till all our guests come, take their seats, and I will not ask my guests about their situation in the countries where they live or work. I will rather start with another approach. We will make, let's say, a cross-reference, cross-vision on what is happening in individual countries. So I will start by Mr. Schwarzenberg of what is his observation of the development in Poland. So we start with Mr. Schwarzenberg. I am not really an expert on Polish policy, but I remember very well my father was really a very good historian, and once we had a very long discussion on Poland, Polish history, and then he said, yes, jeszcze Polska nie zginęła, but which means Poland hasn't died yet, but every generation tries to kill it. And I think this is a problem of Poland. It's a heroic nation, it's a very talented, gifted nation, but sometimes in politics they are not really the smartest. Adam, what happened now? What happened will really object, Adam will object it what happened, but my feeling is that one of the main political streams in Poland since the 19th century were the National Democrats. They were the main Polish force, but they never got a chance. Poland has been divided between Russia, Russians, Germans, Prussia, Prussia and Austria, and they've been always suppressed. After the war, Marshal Piłsudski came to power, after him colonels, and they never had a chance. After the Second World War, communists took power, then there was never ever a possibility or a chance, opportunity, and after 89, it was the people around Solidarność who won and took the power, and this strong Polish stream of national democrats is in between. Under different names, they never came to power. But now, finally, this stream of law and justice came into power, and they really swim in it and enjoy it. And it is Polish right to vote and elect whom they want, but I am an old man now and I remember many things since 1950s. I remember things before the revolution in 1968. A German friend of mine was not happy about Poland and was cursing about Polish, and I asked him, what do you do? So, yeah, because it is so unbearable what they do. But I told him, think of our youth. I remember German policies of the 50s, the end of the 40s, in the 50s, and until 68, so I said, sorry. They are the representatives of Germany then were not so different from what we have in Poland now, but the people who we have today are different, but we had these 50 years to develop, to get forward, to evolve, and Poland had less time, and therefore I believe that these people, the leaders of Poland, stayed at a different era. They are still stuck there. They are mentally in the 50s, 60s of Western Europe, and so I would like to say that I am not happy about what I see in Poland, but we must show more understanding, because every nation nation which went through dictatorship and hardship needs time to develop, to grow. And if we take the Polish, cannot have the same state of mind as Switzerland or Norway, because their history is different. Short reaction by Adam. What do you think? Mr. Schwarzenberg said that Poland has been divided between powers, Russia, Germany, Austria-Hungary played a significant role. There has been always a dividing line in Poland, and it has always been the result of effects of games among the neighboring countries. But who is making dividing lines in Poland today, and why?
Yes, I'm historic. Yes, I'm
I am a historian. I studied history.
História, dejiny sú veľmi dôležité.
And history is very important.
Snažil som sa dodržiavať to,
and when I did so, I tried to follow the line of explaining everything according to the historic tradition.
And if we
had a dictatorship tomorrow in France, everyone would remember
the kings, slnko, a na tú centralizovanú moc,
decentralized power under the Sun King, and all the other events which followed. But today
we have
democratic France and democratic parties. That is the evolution from France today. And today in Poland, and there I agree with Karel what he said, we see
pozitívnu, tak aj negatívnu. A to preto,
a positive or negative role played by the fact that the Polish like freedom very much,
and búriť,
they
slobodu,
can
protestovať
revolt,
a tá negatívna stránka je tá, že
fight for freedom, and the negative experience is that there is no experience with democracy. They don't understand that democracy is freedom vis-à-vis the constitution, the state organization, and therefore in Poland we have always had some strong tendencies, nationalist tendencies, populist tendencies,
and
Poland is the only V4 country that has always been against Hitler. From the very first day, we were the country that revolted most often, and in 1956, that was Hungary, in 1968, Czechoslovakia, or in 1980, when Solidarność was born.
Tak to, čo sa stalo v Polsku
so
teraz,
what happened today in Poland
buď, is
either we have entered a different path, or it is an accident while working. I travel a lot in Poland, I meet democratic groups and people, and I always tell them, remember that Poland is a country which ended with Soviet communism, and Poland will also end the good change. And what we see today
is
a consequent Putinization of Poland, because Poland becomes a country which is
vzoru Viktora Orbána, na druhej strane je tam vzor
following the
Putina,
model of Orbán, also of Putin, and in between we have Poland.
Polska.
It's a very sad moment in the history of Poland.
My ich ponaháňame, naozaj ponaháňame ich.
But we will really chase them. The Polish are often very naive, they have a short-lived memory, it is easy to cheat them.
But
if to talk about the future, they don't want to be perceived as idiots, and these people in power make them idiots. So,
a hovorím rôzne absurdality, pretože špecifikum Polska je katolická cirkev.
Catholic Church is really the specific feature of Poland, and I will speak about it later.
Aby si povedal, čo sa podľa teba deje dnes
I also have a question for you. Could you mention what's happening here in more detail? You mentioned Orbán as the worst example of development in Central Europe, and we are not a very interesting country compared to what's going on in Poland and Hungary. But could you please tell us what do you or how do you see the development in Slovakia? Or could you place Slovakia of today in together with Germany and France in the so-called core of Europe? Adam, could you tell us?
Nikdy som nebol entuziastom.
I was never an enthusiastic supporter of Prime Minister Fico, but I have to say that from the Polish point of view, he behaves in a very rational way. In comparison, the Polish government takes an absurd position. And what should I say about Slovakia? In this respect, my ideas are rather unconventional. 1 year ago, here in Bratislava, in the presence of Prime Minister Radičová, I said that Slovakia, it is a point of hope for all of us, including us in Poland, and I'm quite amazed. She said, why do you say so? I said, because Slovaks succeeded doing two things. First of all, they got rid of Mečiar, and Mečiar was the one using the language of Slovak nationalism and populism, and we have to recognize he was successful, but you, Slovaks, you got rid of him. And second, it was the presidential election when Prime Minister Fico lost. And Slovakia today has a very wise president who says things that I would only dream our leaders to say, our president, namely. This is impossible, because if our president is saying something, it is better if he does not speak at all, but if he doesn't speak, he uses demagoguery, cliches, but Kiska addresses real problems in Europe. So today I am a Slovakophil, and the latest municipal the latest elections for self-governing regional authorities, it is a signal also for Poland, showing that people can gain their courage and say and do what's necessary.
When
we met with Mr. Haraszti in the backstage, I signaled what I might ask him today. He will speak about Hungary, because I believe that nobody really knows what's going on in Hungary, so we hope Mr. Haraszti will know. But Mr. Haraszti told me he doesn't know what country Hungary is, but still he's got a Hungarian passport and he's been living for a long time in Hungary. He knows the Hungarian society. So today you have the task or even a duty to explain people sitting here what's going on in Hungary today. Miklós Haraszti, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much.
Ďakujem veľmi pekne.
The answer is really depending on the length.
Odpoveď skutočne závisí od toho, koľko minút ste mi dali. Tá krátka odpoveď je taká, ako povedal Adam. Je to putinizácia, erdoganizácia, nazarbajzibizácia, lukašenkoizácia. A existujú rôzne stupne tohto procesu. Mohol by som
povedať niečo presnejšie o tom, kde sa nachádzame, pretože určite vďaka našej zemepisnej šírke a členstvu v EÚ v našej krajine nevládne násilie. To je veľký rozdiel zo systémového hľadiska v porovnaní s putinizmom a erdoganizmom, ale je to práve tá povaha, je to tá totálna, to totálne zmocnenie sa moci a potláčanie všetkých nezávislých zložiek moci, potláčanie plurality v spoločnosti a v politike. To je to, čo je problém. A pretože je to aj riziko násilia, keby hrozilo, že príde vláda o moc. To nebezpečenstvo zatiaľ nehrozí. A ja chápem to, čo povedal Karel o úlohe ideológie v Poľsku. My to v Maďarsku nevidíme. Tá hra v Maďarsku sa týka jednoducho uchopenia moci. A pán Orbán urobil jednu strategickú chybu v porovnaní s Poľskom, s pánom Kaczyńskim, a síce, že jeho systém je absolútne skorumpovaný. A takisto urobil tú chybu, že obohacoval svoju rodinu. Dejiny nás učia, že to všetko sa mu vráti v podobe pomsty. Nemohol by som, či nevedel by som povedať nič konkrétne, ale dovolte mi povedať jednu vec. Od začiatku, to znamená od roku 1989, Maďarsko kopírovalo krásny príklad Poľska v type okrúhleho stola pri prechode k demokracii. Tento okrúhly stôl bol takisto v porovnaní s Poľskom, s Slovenskom, s Českou republikou chybný. Urobili sme jednu chybu, pretože všetky tieto tri krajiny Visegrádskej štvorky mali pomerný systém volieb, kde bola zachovaná pluralita v politike a kde existovala záruka, že po čase sa vráti strana, ktorá prehrala. Ale v Maďarsku parlament rozhoduje o všetkom a s dvojtretinovou väčšinou môže zmeniť ústavu, môže eliminovať nezávislé súdnictvo, ústavný súd. A to je presne ten systém, ktorý mohol Orbán využiť na svoje absolútne uchopenie moci. Áno, Karel má pravdu, Adam má pravdu. Treba veriť v cnosti týchto národov, demokratické inštinkty, ale nikdy nedovolte zmeniť volebný systém na nepomerný, pretože títo ľudia tam vyčkávajú. Kaczyński, či už s ideológiou alebo bez ideológie, by bol pripravený vydať sa cestou totálnej moci, keby sa zmenil volebný systém.
Teraz poukázali na jeden.
Miklós, Haraszti, you have pointed out one phenomenon. It is quite interesting that in addition to all the words that you used to denote what's going in Hungary, you did not mention urbanization, because urbanization is perhaps more important than Putinization and Erdoganization. But you also said one thing. In contrast to what's going on in Poland, in today's Hungary, ideology plays no role. Does it mean that Central Europe will have to be prepared for the danger, for a situation where the danger will not come from large ideological complexes or large ideological entities? Myslím, že áno, ja neberím nejaké postmoderné ideológie, ja nehlásam takéto ideológie. Ja si myslím, že je potrebné, aby hrali svoju úlohu v systéme plurality, lebo v plurality, ale v plurality ide o podstatu, nejde o rôzne ideológie. Ideológie môžu zohrať užitočnú úlohu vtedy, keď právny a ústavný systém umožní pluralitu. Vtedy môžu pokryť mapu, môžu politickú, ideologickú, teologickú, sociologickú mapu môžu pokryť. Ale to, čo vidíme v Maďarsku, to je totálna zmes etatistickej ultrapravicovej, xenofobnej, protizápadnej ideológie. Je tu také malé détente s pánom Picom, ale čakajte teraz, čo sa udeje neskôr. Myslím, že to nepotrvá dlho, pretože v povahe liberálnych a populistických mechanizmov je neísť do jadra otázok či veci, ale zamiesť ich pod koberec a snažiť sa o zvýšenie svojej popularity. Preto lídri otvárajú tzv. Kvázi ideologický dáždník a majú isté ideologické hesla. Tá otázka je iná. V povahe týchto krajín nie je vydávať sa cestou postideologického populizmu. Táto, je to otázka, ktorá je globálna. Svet sa stal viac strediskový, multicentristický a ekonomické myslenie, ktoré prišlo zo západu, sa už rozšírilo po celom svete. A pán Dzurinda tiež hovorí, že ten internet takisto nezohráva vždy užitočnú úlohu, pozitívnu úlohu. A to všetko platí pre celý kontinent. Dnes už nemáme žiadne super ego a musíme byť pripravení na pomerne dlhú éru takéhoto populizmu. Prepačte, ja som Maďar a preto hovorím snáď príliš dlho, mali by ste ma prerušiť. Mr. Kusý, we have heard diagnostics of larger countries. We are one of the smallest European countries, and for many years we believed we became part of something. We became part of the Union and of other international organizations, but we know that it came at a cost of a very hard work. But tonight you will have the task to tell us what really happened in Central Europe and whether the Visegrad 4 that initially pretended that it has something to say vis-a-vis Western European countries. Today it seems that the Visegrad group has become a sort of an anti-immigration bloc. In the past, people in Western Europe did not really know what the Visegrad group is. Today they know it's the bloc of countries that do not want immigration. Do you agree?
There are hot discussions carried on what Central Europe is. They've started already in the 1980s. or Kundera and others, we know the history. I don't want to join these discussions on what is Central Europe. It would be too theoretical. But I want to tell you what we thought then about Central Europe. Hitler broke down what has been called Central Europe before the war, and then it was very difficult to put it together, and Churchill and the Iron Curtain has split it to east and west, whether we wanted it or not. We have become the part of the east. But it wasn't very pleasant. I mean, none of the countries which became a part of that, neither the East Germans nor the Czechs or the Slovaks, the Hungarians as well, nobody liked this designation, this name, you are the East. They all objected it, and the dissent was a cradle of the idea of returning to the idea of Central Europe. It is like a maneuver to hide certain things. We couldn't say that we are a part of the West because there was this Iron Curtain, and the West has accepted the Iron Curtain, and they have accepted that we are part of the East. So for us, it was a way how to get out of the East by putting emphasis on the concept of Central Europe. We are not a part of the East. We are a part of Central Europe. That is also what the East Germans would say, the Czechs and the Slovaks and the Hungarians. It was a kind of defense of becoming a part of the East. And that would be the basis of our understanding of Central Europe. When Josef Antal, Václav Havel, and Lech Walesa came with the idea to put together a concept of Visegrad, then I think it was not so much about the revival of the idea of Central Europe, but it was more the idea of European integration by saying our main objective is European integration. If you take the founding document of the Visegrad grouping, there you will not find anywhere a term of Central Europe. It mentions European integration. That was our objective. The first thing we did in Slovakia was a march to Europe, not a march to Central Europe. When we crossed the border after the Velvet Revolution, so it was a tool. Yes, it was a tool to confirm an identity. Yes, it was a tool that was important then. And what now? What is happening today with this group of countries? This idea has lost its leitmotif because the European integration has taken place in all participating countries. For instance, Slovakia made significant progress or advancement, and that is an issue in mutual relationships, but this idea has served the idea of European integration, and what we do today is to try to find substitute objectives. A month ago, I've been to Brussels, and the Hungarians have invited me to a conference on the occasion of presidency of the Visegrad group. And the spirit of that event was that Visegrad is a beautiful, promising idea which means development for all the countries, but that was claimed only by the Hungarians. the Czechs represented by Mr. Vondra, who supported the Hungarians, but the Polish representative was rather skeptical, and I was very skeptical on this idea, and I said that this idea has already survived its climax. Do you think, Mr. Kusý, that Visegrad, in the form it exists, should really split? I think that it's a group, a grouping which exists, has its institutes like the Visegrad Fund, so it can play a useful role in this form, but it cannot have objectives which are not theirs, like, for instance, creation of a central European group that will have a special role. Mr. Schwarzenberg? The question is whether there is Central Europe or not, and it depends on the definition. Yeah, I have a different definition than Mr. Kusý. I see a space, an area, which in contrast to Western Europe has never went through reforms bottom-up, which has been considered an advantage. We have always said that enlightened rulers do the reforms like Maria Theresa, Joseph II, etc. The economic reform in Central Europe were done by neo-absolutistic rulers at the beginning of the 50s of the 19th century, and in the West it were different revolutions, the French bourgeois revolution, etc., etc. So the reforms, revolutions were bottom up, but not in the eastern part of the continent. The Western Europe had Renaissance, humanism, enlightenment, etc. Liberal changes in the 19th century, and Central Europe is defined by the fact that many forms and many inventions came from the West, but through the enlightened ruler from the top. Even after 1989, everything has been done top to bottom. And we have a similar tendency not to care so much about democracy. And when you look at the ruling parties or the cabinets after elections, then in Central Europe, in Austria, Hungary, Slovakia, Poland, and the Czech Republic, we'll see a certain deviation from democracy. We are bored by democracy, and we are rather inclined to go to follow a leader, an enlightened ruler. We had this experience in the 1930s. It was a great success, probably, and it is still deep in us. Take the rich Austria. Is now following or keeping more to a poorer Hungary. The new chancellor is a friend of Orbán, and we see that the Masaryk's democracy is boring to people. So we have this tendency to authoritarian leadership across the whole Central Europe, Kundera, Musil, and Márai are not so effective anymore.
Existující celek.
And what I have described is in the whole Central Europe, and the Visegrad 4 has been overvalued. It's a very pragmatic grouping, which has done a lot of useful things, good work at the level of ministries and their cooperation. Not many know that the Visegrad 4 has no common office, and the Secretary General is following a rotation principle like the presidency. And we had certain successes when joining the EU, when trying to do away with the visa obligation with the US, but it were more or less today, let's say, unilateral declarations by Orbán, who said that everybody agrees with his views, which is not true. The Visegrad 4 is not so united as Viktor Orbán claims.
First Miklós, and then you.
Very briefly.
Len veľmi rýchlo. Môžem tak skombinovať, čo Karel a Miroslav povedali. Áno, pôvodný plán Visegrádu bol dobehnúť Európu a možno aj dobehnúť ten klasický spôsob demokratizácie smerom z dola nahor, ale k tomu nedošlo. A chcem veľmi stručne povedať, že Orbánovo vodcovstvo má za cieľ usadenia svojho modelu vládnutia a jeho rozšírenia do krajín Vyšehradskej skupiny. A táto falošná stredoeurópska identita, o ktorej hovoril Miroslav, tak u Orbána je to tak, že keď on hovorí o strednej Európe, jeho identita spočíva v tom, že ju neopisuje nejako noblesne, tak ako to hovoril, a cnostne, ako hovoril Karel, keď hovoril o totalite a nedostatku demokratických zvykov. Jeho cieľom je vytvoriť lokálnu vládu práva, populisticko-autoritatívne, neliberálne zoskupenie. Bojte sa jeho vodcovstva. Nech už je to akákoľvek ideológia, ktorú si zvolí, tie zmeny a všetko, čo robí, vedie k jeho cieľu. To je jeho verzia dvojrýchlostnej Európy. Európa má akceptovať, že v tejto časti Európy je iná predstava právneho štátu, iná predstava toho, čo oni volajú európske hodnoty, a že tieto neexistujú, a čo existuje, je vláda svoloče zosilnená štátnou vládou, moc ulice zosilnená štátnou vládou. My musíme ale vytvoriť rezistentnosť, odpor V4 proti týmto trendom a vrátiť sa k tomu, o čo si pamätá Miroslav, a to je, že našim cieľom je dobehnúť demokraciu a právny štát. Nie nevyhnutne tak, ako je to na západe alebo na úrovni západu. Niektorí ľudia totiž myslia, že západ je len nový imperializmus podobný moskovskému, to je tá Orbánovská línia, ale nemali by sme k tomu pristupovať geograficky, mali by sme k tomu pristupovať z hľadiska hodnot. Čo je ten odpor, rezistencia, resistance V4. Ak sa neliberálne režim stane víťazom, tak potom politické strany sú už mimo, sú von z hry. Je to skutočnosť v Maďarsku a skoro skutočnosť v Poľsku. Čo sa stane s občianskou spoločnosťou a slobodnými médiami? A z toho by mal vychádzať odboj, resistance, a takto vznikne nová politická pluralita, ktorá dokáže odolávať totalitným snahám. Ale dôležité je zachovať pluralizmus, na, aspoň na úrovni médií, novinárov, investigatívnu žurnalistiku. To by ma zaujímalo, ako Kaczyński a korupcia vyzerajú. Či si Adam myslí, že Kaczyński je úplne čistý z hľadiska korupcie. Orbánovská skúsenosť je taká, že absolútna moc nevyhnutne vedie k obohacovaniu vlastnej rodiny, k vytváraniu rodinných klanov a ich obohacovaniu. A vlastne to je to, na čo sa treba zamerať. Ak Orbán znovu získa dvojtretinovú ústavnú väčšinu v apríli, keď budeme mať voľby, tak transformuje Maďarsko do putinovského, erdoganovského typu prezidentskej republiky s plebiscitnou legitimáciou miesto voličskej legitimizácie. A to je tiež niečo, čo by sme my vo V4 mali odháňať.
To veľa tématov bolo.
Hovorilo sa tu na veľa tém.
A number of issues have been addressed here.
Som chápal vesti ako
one concerning the constitution of VPOR. VPOR was first conceived as something that was similar to what was going in the Balkans, but whereas in the Balkans they had a bloody war, the Visegrad group was to become a signal that things can be dealt with in another fashion. And when the before was created, it came about after a bloodless revolution, and Václav Havel did everything in order to attract Slovakia to Western European institutions. So it was one fact, and the second fact is that we are not only dealing here with geography. What we are dealing with is our common history, because we all know that Hungary was part of the Hitler's coalition, and Czechoslovakia was betrayed in Munich, it was dismembered, and Slovakia became part of the post-Hitlerian coalition in the form of a protectorate. I believe that all this that was observed later on in the film, in culture, in the theater, it all shows that there are some specific topics, common topics, common issues specific to this region. It is not a coincidence that in Poland a few years ago
objavený maďarský autor spôsobom bestselleru Sándor
Márai. Hungarian author Sándor Márai was suddenly discovered and his books became bestsellers. Also the books of Kundera represent a mirror.
A takéto určité prepojenie je veľmi dôležité.
Showing,
a ešte chvíľočku mi dajte,
a mirror for the governments. This is also quite important. I also would like to answer
na tému pána Kaczyńskiego.
The question of Miklós concerning Mr. Kaczyński.
Kaczyński's
problem is that he is not corrupt. He is a very Puritan. He is modest. He has a cat. He loves animals, which cannot be said about his relations to people. I like to repeat that Jaroslav Kaczyński loves all the people in the world except for men and women. So he loves everybody. but not men and women.
On skutočnosti jeho vôbec peniaze nezaujímajú
ani. In reality, he is not interested in money, he is not interested in good cuisine, young women, boys. The only thing that's interesting for him is power and revenge.
A v tomto zmysle.
And it is in this sense
určitú cnosť,
ktorú
vyžadoval Hitler aj od gestapovcov,
čiže that Hitler also demanded from his gestapo,
pokiaľ vy
which means
od Židov, ktorí boli spálení zlaté
zuby, long as you
ich nemôžete schovávať do vlastných vreckách, ale všetky musíte dávať do pokladnice Tretej ríše.
Čiže
išlo o to, aby ten
both camps, you cannot keep them for yourselves, you must give them in the common treasury, so it means that the Nazis had to be honest, and Kaczynski is also honest in this manner, because he is not stealing, but this cannot be said of his surroundings, of people around him.
Na Polsko nepochybne čaká ďalšia etapa.
Poland is undoubtedly facing the next stage.
Čiže uvidíme, že
similar to what was done in Budapest by Viktor Orbán. So we will see what will happen.
Mr. Kusý wants to say something on Visegrad. I wanted to quote Miklós Haraszti and Mr. Schwarzenberg, what they have said in 2002. We had a conference here in Bratislava on Central Europe then, and it was also published. Karel Schwarzenberg said then, and after that we experienced the 90s, and I remember everyone speaking only about us belonging to the West. There was no Central Europe mentioned. And Mr. Haraszti was very skeptical in saying Visegrad will be maintained at such a low level as it is today, that is then in 2002. It will be a regular opportunity for the diplomats to be photographed, or it will be a theme for conferences. That is what Haraszti said. And then he continued, Visegrad spirit as this common interest has never become alive. It has to be born somewhere in the future. So Mr. Haraszti called for Visegrad resistance. Does it mean that Central Europe will emerge as identity only then, when a part of the population will feel threatened by ideologies or non-ideologies by politicians like Orbán or these virtue-based politicians like Kaczynski? To, čo som povedal, je návrat k tomu, čo povedal Miroslav, čo pripomenul ako pôvodné chápanie pojem. Áno, vzdor, odpor voči našim vodcom, najmä voči Kaczynskému a Orbánovi, snaha a ich snahe zvrátiť Visegrád do falošnej identity vzdoru proti demokratickým hodnotám. A tento odpor, vzdor si má uvedomiť toto nebezpečie. A takto možno sa znovu začne ten pôvodný projekt dobehnutia demokracie. To, čo my nazývame západná kvalita demokracie, Možno, že raz, respektíve historici medzi nami môžu na to reagovať, možno, že raz v živote týchto demokracií, jediný raz v živote v týchto demokracií, tieto národy, ktoré nazývame západné, si uvedomili, že môžete stratiť slobodu aj zvnútra, nie zvonka, že to môže byť aj výsledok vnútornej situácie, politickej volie. A jednoducho to pochopili, chopili sa toho, začali bojovať proti tomu a porazili to. Tým sa stali odolnými, rezistentnými, stalo sa to súčasť ich politickej pamäte, politických génov a vždy pocítia a cítia toto nebezpečie, keď sa vynorí, pretože toto je nebezpečie, ktoré sa občas vynára a to nám chýba vo Visegráde a možno táto výzva, tento problém urbanizácie, kačinskizácie, ten cynizmus, to, čo vlastne oni predstavujú, to totálne uchopenie moci a znovu vykladanie demokracie a že takým spôsobom, že čo chňapneš je tvoje a keď si uvedomíme toto nebezpečie z doma nahor, ako hovoril Karel, tak potom možno tá demokracia postavená na západných hodnotách sa zrodí, pretože sme sa naučili, ako vzdorovať tomuto nebezpečiu, o ktorom hovorí Karel, ktoré je oveľa akutnejšie v tejto časti sveta. Mr. Schwarzenberg?
Ja sa jenom ptám, kto vzdoruje.
I only want to ask who resists. Look at the election results recently, Hungary, Austria, the Czech Republic, Poland. Sorry, those who resist are a very small minority. We may feel great, be elite minority, but it doesn't help. We have to convince the majority that this development is a threat to them as well. So unless we manage to achieve that, we might be intellectually very interesting, but politically we are not so interesting. And we are no weight. It's really the situation so that the wind is blowing into our face and we see more authoritarian outcries throughout Europe. We must realize that the good years are gone.
Adam. Ja myślę, że żeby
ja si myslím, že
I believe,
to, my sme nemali takto slovne vnímať to, čo hovorí náš priateľ Karel
Schwarzenberg. Taking every word of what our friend Karel Schwarzenberg says.
Cez Karola hovorí taká múdrosť legionov, taká
múdrosť,
národná múdrosť, taká
national,
múdrosť,
people's wisdom,
Rakúska, ktorá sa rozpadla a teraz to tak nebude.
Austria, which has split, but it won't be that way, it will all change, because I am convinced that now
It was a very difficult way to democracy. A táto cesta, ktorá je trnistá, trvá do dnes.
It is, as I said, a thorny way which continues.
Určite vieme to,
but what we know for sure is
autoritatívna demokracia,
that authoritarian democracy
je to isto ako nejaké topiace sa snehové gule, lebo také niečo neexistuje. Môže to byť na papieri,
it may be put on paper, but in real life it doesn't exist. Because authoritarian democracy doesn't exist. Erdogan, who says or speaks about democracy, what has it with democracy to do? Nothing. And Secondly, if we follow the whole process, we see what the trap number one and the leaders, like Putin and others, Orban, maybe do it instinctively and not consciously. Maybe also Kaczynski, they act as if they understood from where Hitler's power came. Because Hitler came to power not with slogans like "I will start Holocaust," "I will start the Second World War." Nobody spoke so beautifully about peace. He really described peace in superlatives. But what's important are two aspects. The first one is that the whole social sector,
this pomoc, care,
there was a lot of it, but in other countries, in other European countries,
liberálnej demokracie sa ľudia pozerali s takým obdivom, pretože to robili
dojem. In the countries of liberal democracies watched and listened to it with admiration, because those who were the most needy in Germany were really helped, but not in France. And then this nationalism, it is really poison to democracy.
Karel hovorí, že
Karel says
nie sú horší nacionalisti a šovinisti ako
liberáli. There are no worse nationalists and chauvinists than liberals.
Ale podľa mojej mienky,
in my view,
problémom tejto časti
the
Európy,
problem in this part of Europe,
že okrem Československa sme tu nemali neoliberálov.
Is the fact that except for Czechoslovakia we never had neoliberals. Masaryk was a liberal, but in Poland we never had liberals. We had never liberal representatives. Maybe they were somewhere at universities in dark corridors, but the country was split between two authoritarian powers. The first was the project of the Democrats, which I mentioned, and Piłsudski's model, who fought for freedom, but he wasn't a Democrat, he was an anti-Democrat.
Bol charizmatický vodca.
He was a charismatic leader.
Kaczynski má všetky chyby Piłsudského a je ani jednu jeho výhodu, pozitívnu stránku.
Takže keď sa nám pýtali vo Vilniuse na to, že Kaczynski je nový z Piłsudský, tak som povedal, že rozdiel medzi Piłsudským a Kaczynským spočíva v tom, že je v dolároch, pretože
to je taká najlepšia mena na svete.
Is in dollars, because that is the best currency in the world. And I believe
to, čo nás dnes najviac ohrozuje, je
the threat to us today
takého projektu,
is the success of a project
sociálna pomoc sa spája s
nacionalizmom. Social assistance, social help is combined with nationalism. Because when Kaczynski says
Polsko
Poland
povstalo z kolien,
has arisen,
cituje Putina,
and he quotes Putin even by not knowing it. And if Orban says that
o Trianone, o Veľkom Maďarsku,
or mentions Trianon and Great Hungary,
then
he gives the Hungarians a certain illusion, a kind of a promise he will be never able to deliver without a war, without a military intervention. And I believe that even today, when we have this not very favorable international constellation, because we have what the Germans would call Zeitgeist, the spirit of the times, is so the Zeitgeist of today is influenced by Brexit, the situation in Catalonia, the US and their Trump. All this influences the spirit of the era.
Sa môžeme naozaj veľmi trápiť a obávať,
really
pretože na jednej strane máme Putina, na druhej strane máme Trumpa.
and concerned, because on the one hand we have Putin, on the other hand we have Trump, then add China to it, and it's not a good constellation for democracy. We don't have so much more time, but what I want to say, despite listening to all the speeches about the Visegrad resistance, we could say that the last 2 years are European Dunkirk. We don't know whether it is a strategic retreat or only retreat. But at any rate, the answer or the question that all of us would like to hear the answer to is whether anything can be done, if it is possible to somehow find a way out, or, like Adam said a while ago, that this will not continue to be the way it is, that it will change. Miklós was the fastest when it comes to grabbing the microphone, so Miklós will start.
There is one big failure of Orbán and Kaczynski.
Orbán a Kaczynski urobili jednu veľkú chybu, a to, že štatistiky ukazujú, že tieto dva národy sú veľmi proeurópske. Nie je možné potlačiť európsku identitu napriek tejto pseudonacionalistickej identite boja za slobodu proti Bruselu. Orbán sa mimochodom ani neodvažuje hovoriť o Európskej únii, pretože európska identita Maďarov je silná. On vždy vo svojej propagande hovorí iba o Bruseli. Čiže o odpore k Bruselu. A ako som už povedal, Maďari by mali pokračovať v boji za demokraciu, ale keď hovoríme o dvorýchlostnej Európe, tak sú tu dva rôzne kurzy. Orbán a Kaczynski, pokiaľ viem, už majú vlastný koncept dvorýchlostnej Európy a začali si uvedomovať, predovšetkým Orbán, ktorý už teraz sa snaží získať peniaze, ktoré nahradia kohezné fondy, pokiaľ by prestali prúdiť z Bruselu. Maďarsko zakladá svoju politiku na geopolitike namiesto hodnot, ale netreba sa nechať unášať strachom, že tieto krajiny by opustili EÚ, ako sa to stalo v prípade Brexitu. Boja sa totiž, že by mohli stratiť viac krajín, ktoré by mali autokratické tendencie, ale Orbán v súčasnosti začína požadovať, aby Európa poskytla záruky, aby Európska únia poskytla východnej Európe záruky, že môže mať svoj vlastný koncept právneho štátu a že v opačnom prípade bude ohrozená Európska únia. Toto je v zásade podstata Orbánových vyjadrení. Dvojrýchlostná Európa by mala byť založená na spoločnom právnom poriadku, spoločnej kvalite právnych noriem a už v strednodobom meradle by to malo priniesť užitočné výsledky pre túto časť sveta, lebo ľudia by mohli sa znova pozerať na Európu ako na niečo, čo by chceli dosiahnuť. Orbán hovorí o novej silnej identite a politici, strany a ľudia znovu najdu túto európsku identitu. Ja súhlasím s Karlom v tom, že v súčasnosti by sme mali byť pomerne pesimistickí, pokiaľ ide o to, čo politici dokážu robiť v našich krajinách, ale keď vychádzame zo štatistík o európskej identite, ten duch Visegrádu, duch dobiehania ešte nevyhynul. No.
Jak to všetko? V 70.
Ja len krátko.
V 7. roku.
Čas...
V 77. roku.
Shortly, in 1977, in
vydávať
the Polish underground, we started to publish a political magazine called Criticism. It was an uncensored publication, and we invited Miklós at the time to the sitting of our editorial board, and we also invited Václav Havel. For us, the dissidents, this represented the first concept of our Visegrad. And today, when we have Kaczynski, Orbán, Zeman, Babiš, and when they are going to address the issue of Visegrad, we will have to defend our Visegrad. If we want to hamper this dirty wave of authoritarianism and lawlessness, we have to keep together, because if we will go it alone, we will be destroyed. Prime Minister Fico is quite skillful when it comes to the questions that we are dealing with today. He uses a different language in Brussels and a different language at home. I remember when President Husák gave an interview to Paris Match in France. At that time, that interview would not be published in Czechoslovakia, but we, in the dissent, we translated it and published it because it was a source of incredible fun for us, reading what Husák was telling about Czechoslovakia in 1975. And it seems to me that Prime Minister Fico is trying to do the same thing, that he gives a different picture in Brussels and he paints another picture at home. In this sense, he quite contradicts his statements. And concerning Visegrad, there is a problem of interests, of individual interests. Our interests are quite different, for example, in the area of energy, when the gas pipelines should be led through, etc. Electricity, we only can agree with the Czechs, not with the others. And as regards migration, Fico is able to achieve a situation where the European Union condemns the Czech Republic, Poland and Hungary, but Slovakia is exempt. And speaking about financing, the Slovak finance minister is very skeptical about the possibilities of cooperation within the Visegrad group.
No.
I was trying to find something, but I cannot find it anyway. The statement by our finance minister is quite clear. He says, we will reach an agreement in the EU, but not within the Visegrad group, because our interests are quite divergent. We go different ways. We are in Schengen, and we have a different position from other Visegrad countries, and there is nothing that could point to the possibility of taking the same course within Visegrad. It seems that Mr. Kusý, you did not believe in the future of Visegrad. Well, based on the data received from our economists and journalists, etc., it seems that Visegrad is collapsing at all sides. Why do we sit here then? Because the relations are formal, as Miklós Haraszti said. It is the photo opportunities for diplomats, this is where we are good, but this is where it all ends, because when it comes to interests, we have very different ways. For instance, concerning Poland, the Czech Lidové Noviny wrote recently that Poles lead intensive negotiations with the Americans, and that other countries will also, and the question is whether other countries of the EU will follow the lead of Poland or not, meaning more intensive cooperation with Americans. So we do have different interests.
And, Miro. Nigdy to nie jest tak.
Miro, this is not it is not so that the interests of Kaczyński are identical with the interests of Poles, just as the interests of Husak were not identical with the interests of Slovaks.
And now, Mr. Schwarzenberg, to summarize the Central European wisdom. There is no Central European wisdom, because I'm an old grand man that heard and seen a lot. Our politicians are speaking gloomy speeches, Putin, Istanbul, a lot of threats, but I think that the threat for us is us. And that is by resignation. To resign, to lose hope, it is the threat. Because somebody would say it's the evolution, development, nothing can be done about it, but we have to accept it. That is the worst that can we do. It's true that maybe we are now a minority, I agree. I know that also my position is minority position in the Czech Republic, but it doesn't mean that we have to accept it, that we have to accept the rule of populists and demagogues. If we are a minority, we have to continue. We have to support cooperation in Europe and honesty at home. We cannot give up and say, okay, it is now this period where the others are in power and we have to accept it. I would like to mention one thing. Of course, always, every government speaks in a different manner at home than in Brussels. That's true, because at home, they sell all successes, subsidies, everything they get from Brussels as their success. That is how they sell it, and as their success. And all the evil, all the restrictions is the evil of Brussels. So now when I travel Slovakia, Hungary, the Czech Republic, and I see the cities and villages and how they changed. I meet our people in everywhere in the world. Wherever I go, they are there.
And
as I said, the truth is that we have worked hard, but you may work hard if you don't have money, you won't achieve anything. And money helped us, that's true, but it was European money. It was European money, money of the Dutch, German, etc. taxpayers, and we should be thankful to them and accept it, and we should not always blame Brussels, that they are those who restrict us, who limit us. We should see what we have achieved. Yes, we achieved a lot. But it is like the growth of Germany. Growth of Germany without Marshall Plan was not possible, and our growth without the help from Brussels would not be possible, and we should be open about it. We should name the things what they are. Excellent words to conclude this meeting. And so, if to summarize, if the liberal democracy had the form of Eurofunds, Orbán and Kaczynski would fight for it. But unfortunately, it is only a symbolic memento of what happened in Hungary and Poland and the Czech and Slovak Republics. And Miklós Haraszti was our guest tonight to remember that historic moment. Mr. Adam Michnik from Suicidal Poland. Miroslav Kusý, Bratislava.
A pán Karel Schwarzenberg,
and Mr. Karel Schwarzenberg from the Czech Republic, from a country that has been successfully occupied by Slovak politicians.